ជំរាបសួរសូមស្វាគមន៍មកកម្មវិធីវិភាក្សារបស់នាងស៊ីលីថ្ងៃនេះនាងខ្ញុំមានកិត្តិយសណាស់ដែលបានពិភាក្សាជាមួយនឹងខេលីសូដូច្នេះសូមស្វាគមន៍ខេលីជំរាបសួរជំរាបសួរសុខសប្បាយជាទេ
ខ្មែរខ្ញុំមិនសូវល្អសូវខ្ញុំនិយាយតិចៗបានតិចៗអត់អីទេតាមនិយាយបានប៉ុណ្ណាយកប៉ុណ្ណឹងអរគុណច្រើនដែលខេលីបានអញ្ជើញមកពិភាក្សាជាមួយខ្ញុំថ្ងៃនេះថ្ងៃនេះខ្ញុំចង់និយាយអំពី រឿងភាពយន្តដែលខេលីទៅតែថតឆ្នាំមុននៅប្រទេសស្រុកខ្មែរហើយនឹងចេញបញ្ចាំងនៅLAនៅថ្ងៃសៅរ៍នេះមែនទេចាឈ្មោះកូនហ្នឹងឈ្មោះ
In the Life of Music ជីវិតតន្ត្រីបកប្រែទៅខ្មែរចាជីវិតតន្ត្រីចា
Why is it important for you to show this movie?
Well, this movie is like a love letter to our parents in a way. It tells the story of three different decades in Cambodia, not just about the war, but prior to the war, during the war, and post-war. It's about love and family and kind of like all the things that hold us together. And it's very rooted in the music and how the music plays such a big role in our in tying us to our roots.
You are a movie director, correct?
Yes.
Why do you think it's important to bring a movie about music?
Music is such a big part of the Cambodian culture, and everybody knows that Sin Si Samut is a big part of why a lot of our pop culture still exists today. And it really does inspire you to create stories. And I remember visiting Cambodia about 3 years ago, before we even came up with this concept of having this story being rooted in three different decades in Cambodia. We were inspired by a song, and the song was Jampa Batambong. And we thought, hey, maybe we should try telling a story about the war through these songs. And also, I think I had just watched a documentary called Don't Think I've Forgotten.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and we had screened it at Cambodia Town Film Festival. And after watching that documentary, I was so touched and moved by it that somehow it stayed with me. And then we just had this moment where we thought, hey, we need to make a movie now, you know, we don't want to wait, you know. And so we did. We came up with a concept, you know, we found the money to do it. We went to Cambodia, we filmed it.
How long did it take you to film it?
It took us about 28 days total to film the movie, but we took a 2 weeks break in between because we filmed the movie in chapters, because we called, you know, chapter one, The Song of Love, which is takes place in 1968. And then chapter two is, of course, The Song of Death, because it takes place during the killing fields. Mm-hmm. And then chapter three is The Song of Birth. It's about rediscovering your roots and where you were born and you know, finding your identity through that, through traveling and going back home in essence.
Now, I believe you went to film this movie in Srok Khmer during the time Angelina Jolie filmed First They Killed My Father. What was that like?
It was an interesting experience because I remember my line producer or my associate producer, Johnny Mem, he called me in November before I went to Cambodia, and he said, Caylee, we're filming the movie the same time Angelina Jolie is filming her movie. You think it's going to be a problem? I'm like, we can't do anything about it because our production date is set. Mm-hmm. And he was worried because he was like, we haven't cast anyone. What if she took all the actors? What if she took all the, you know, the production workers? Like, how are we going to make this movie without all those things? And I think that was like a big concern for some of the producers. But we couldn't do anything about it because we were set to go. And I said, I'm sure, you know, we'll work it out. We'll just go. If it's meant to be, we'll find the people we need to find and we'll make this movie.
And it worked out.
It worked out. I mean, some of the actors actually went to film for Angelina Jolie and then came to act on our set.
Wow.
And then they were talking about the movie. And so we were constantly hearing about what was going on in Angelina Jolie's movie, First to Kill My Father. And then some of the assistant camera operators had just worked for Angelina Jolie's movie, and then they came to work for our movie. So we had a lot of like overlapping of production people and of actors and cast members. But it was interesting. It was definitely a challenge because we were definitely sifting through like all the creatives, you know, production people, and finding ourselves going, oh no, they're on Angelina Jolie's set. Oh no, they're on Angelina Jolie's set. So like, where are we gonna find, you know, like the production designer or things like that? I mean, at the end of the day, it worked out, but it was definitely a challenge. So thank you, Angelina Jolie.
Yeah. So was this your first experience in Sri Lanka?
As far as being in Cambodia, no. Yeah. I went there like 3 times before we shot the movie.
Okay.
The first time I went to Cambodia was in 2011.
Mm-hmm.
And that was just because I had never been. My parents never went back, you know, after the war.
Mm-hmm.
And I had always just wanted to see it. So me and my husband took a trip there in 2011.
Okay.
And then I constantly found a reason to keep going back because, you know, I kept wanting to see and learn and hear more.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, why do you think it's important to keep making movies about the war? Don't you think it's time for us to move on?
You know, that's the mentality, I guess, that some of us do have because we say we're oversaturated with films about the war, but it's such a big part of our narrative.
Mm-hmm.
You know, nothing that we have done right now hasn't been traced back to the war, right?
Mm-hmm.
So there's all these stories yet to be discovered, and I feel like people are still trying to discover those stories before they can move on. And in a way, I think I almost tried to stay away from telling a Killing Fields story just because of that, but found myself telling a Killing Fields story anyway, which is like the most ironic thing.
Mm-hmm.
Because in film school, one of my classmates was always like, you need to tell a Killing Fields story. I'm like, no, everyone's telling a Killing Fields story.
Yes.
And then 4 years later, you know, I found myself wanting to tell like at least a small portion of a Killing Fields story that affected maybe like the bigger overall picture. Yeah. And if you think about it, if I had asked you to name me 5 films, feature films, that was about the Killing Fields, what would you come up with?
I will come up with 2.
2.
First is The Killing Field, the original.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
And then the second one, First They Kill My Father. That's it.
That's the 2
that's
that you
the
came
only
up
2
with?
I know.
Yeah. I could probably come up with 4.
Okay.
You know, The Last Reel.
Oh, The Last Reel. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you see, I think it's because we live in a world where we talk about the Killing Fields a lot. We have a Genocide Remembrance Day. There's a whole bunch of documentaries about the Killing Fields. But if you step outside of our community or out their inner circle, there's still a lot of people, a lot of population that doesn't know anything about the Killing Fields. And it's still new to them. So I guess no and yes at the same time. When it's time for us to move on, we'll move on. But I think right now, there's still a lot of stories to be explored. Like what happened after the Killing Fields during the refugee camp times.
Yeah. What messages do you hope the young generations will get out of this movie?
In the life of music, I think it's not more of a, I don't try to say there's a message I want to get out of the movies that I make. I hope that they feel something when they watch the movie. I hope that they feel a sense of connectedness to the story, to the history, to the music, to the culture. But as far as like a message, I think, you know, every audience should kind of interpret what they can from the film that they're watching. So,
when you were making this film, did you have a mind of the older generation in mind? Like, how would they feel when they watch this? Would it trigger their post, you know, depression?
Traumatic,
or, yeah. Did you consider that when making this film?
I feel like if you're making a movie about the Killing Fields, there's gonna be some memories brought up.
Mm-hmm.
So you try to keep it as respectful as possible, mm-hmm. While at the same time being as truthful and authentic as possible to the story that you're trying to tell.
Okay. Angelina, sorry for going back, she mm-hmm. said on her set she had kind of like a prayer center for the actors and actresses if they need support while filming. Did you have some kind of the same situation during the time you filmed yours?
No, we did not. Mainly because we did not have a big enough budget to have any kind of prayer center. But we were always next to a temple. If there was ever a situation that needed to be, handled, we would stop. We would have someone counsel, things like that.
Okay.
But for the most part, I think the cast and crew handled the subject matter very well.
Okay. Yeah. Very good. Now, any other challenges besides finding the cast and all this production to put the movies together? Any other challenges like the heat or, the language and stuff?
The noise in Cambodia. Yeah, there was a lot of challenges filming in Cambodia, and it was the first time I had ever done it. So of course, we're filming in three different decades, trying to represent kind of three different eras, and with that, you're moving from location to location to location, and you only have a short time span to do it in. We had literally 3 days to build the village, so we had lost our production designer on one of the chapters because he had to go build a village in the middle of nowhere, and so we had picked a location one time, and I guess the nearby landowners were cutting down trees. Mm-hmm. So I came on set one day and just found that this location that we had picked just 3 days ago no longer existed because they had cut down this lovely tree that I wanted to film. And I was just so heartbroken because I was like, it was such an amazing tree. Things like that. It was definitely an interesting experience.
Wow. When we come back, we will hear more about the challenges that Caylee So went through while filming her movie in Cambodia. It's beautiful. I can't wait to watch it. Now, there will be a screening in LA this coming Saturday, correct?
Yes, it's actually our world premiere. It'll be the first time we're going to show it to an audience full of people. So we're very excited about it, very nervous about it, but you know, it's our baby is going out into the world.
Yes, congratulations.
Thank you.
It's a big accomplishment. Now, how do people purchase the tickets?
They can go online to inthelifeofmusic.com, mm-hmm. And you'll find out information on how to buy the tickets there.
Okay.
Or you can go to the LA Asian Pacific Film Festival website, mm-hmm. and go to their schedule, and you'll find In the Life of Music, and then you can purchase a ticket off of there as well.
Okay. How long is the movie?
The movie is about an hour and 30 minutes, an hour and 32 minutes long.
Okay. Are there any future screening in other states or in the United States?
Yes, absolutely. We're making our way, I guess, in the U.S. right now domestically, and then we'll take it international, and then we'll have a Cambodia release sometime soon, probably the end of this year or the beginning of next year.
Okay. So for people who are not in the L.A. area, can go to In the Life of Music website to follow the schedule then?
Yeah. You can go to inthelifeofmusic.com or you can follow us on Facebook, and then we'll try to keep everybody updated as far as when we're gonna screen, where we're gonna screen, and you know, hopefully we'll come to your city.
Mm-hmm. Will it be screened at Cambodia Town Film Festival this year?
This year, no. We will probably end the festival runs at Cambodia Town Film Festival. Because we're starting in LA and then we'll come back to Long Beach probably sometimes next September.
Oh, okay, I see. So you co-direct this movie with Sokwit Sao. How was the experience like?
Well, initially when we first wrote the script, we were supposed to have three directors. The idea was to have three different stories in three different decades, directed by three different directors, so we would treat it as a short film. And then somewhere along the line, you know, I had creative differences with the second director, which was who was a very, very talented filmmaker. But we had creative differences, and so it ended up being just me and Vasal. And initially, Vasal was going to direct the first chapter, which is called The Song of Love. And it was a chapter about how two people fell in love, you know, to a song. And I was supposed to direct the third chapter, which is a very Cambodian American story about returning to Cambodia and reconnecting with your roots, and so that was very like me, you know. And then the other director was supposed to direct the chapter on the killing fields. Mm. And while we were in Cambodia and we were doing pre-production, it ended up being just me and Vasal. And I said, Vasal, why don't we co-direct? So we ended up co-directing a good portion of the movie, but it was a great experience because I think you have to learn to be generous and mm-hmm. collaborative, mm-hmm. And there was a lot of conversations, and I think me and Vasal had talked about the script more than me and the other director, and so we knew what we wanted out of the story, mm-hmm. and the story kind of evolved in a very organic way. And I remember Vasal had shot the first chapter, mm-hmm. and all of his actors were the younger actors. We had did the auditions together, we had selected the actors together, and the lead character, one of the lead character, was this 17, 18 year old girl. And while he was filming her, I thought, wow, she's just, you know, she's so captivating. Like, I just loved the way she looked, the way she acted, the subtlety in her performance. And after watching him film that, and because I'm one of the writers of the script, when we took the 2 weeks hiatus to reset to shoot chapter two, mm-hmm. which is, you know, the Song of Death, and it's about the killing fields, she wasn't originally in it as much as she is now, but mm-hmm. I was just, you know, so captivated by her. I was like, no, I need to know what this character is doing during this chapter. So I remember sitting down and just rewriting that entire chapter so that I could include her more in the story.
Wow.
And it happened in 2 weeks, and it evolved and changed.
That's
so
amazing.
Organically, yeah. I mean, I guess as an independent filmmaker and the writer of your own script, you can do that.
Yes.
I don't know how it is in other script, but I think I gave myself the leeway and I was open to just kind of the story finding us.
Hmm.
Yeah.
How long did the editing part take?
We've been in post-production for about 2 years.
That's longer than filming itself.
It is. I think mainly because we had a very small crew.
Mm-hmm.
We had a very small post-production crew. And again, it was also trying to, you know, make sure that we could tell the best possible story that we can tell with the film that we shot.
Mm-hmm. Now, I see Ellen Wong is in the movie. How did you get a hold of her?
Oh, you know, Ellen, I had met Ellen about the second year of the Cambodia Town Film Festival, and we just became fast friends, and we kept in touch. And then when we had this idea for this movie, I talked to her about possibly starring in it, and she agreed to. So we went to Cambodia, and she starred in the movie, and here we are.
Congratulations on that one.
Thank you.
Now, anything else you would like the audience to know about the movie?
Go see it. It'll be a wonderful experience. Take your parents, take your grandmothers, grandfathers. I think it'll be a very nostalgic kind of movie.
Mm-hmm.
We feature a lot of songs by Sin Sisamut. Actually, we focus a lot on the songs written and sung by Sin Sisamut. So there's definitely a good throwback there for a lot of adults. And yeah.
So it's a family-friendly movie, right?
Maybe not for babies or anybody under like the age of 12.
Okay.
So
it's PG-13 then?
Yeah, PG-13, I would say. We do cover the killing fields and you know, it's English subtitles.
So it's speaking in Khmer then?
Yeah.
Okay.
About 90% of the movie is in Khmer.
Thank you, Caylee, for coming on my show. Is there any messages you would like the audience to know?
Sure. I just thank you for having me on your show today. I really enjoyed that conversation. And I hope that you guys could all come out to LA this Saturday at the Eritani Theater, 5 p.m. For our world premiere. You can go to inthelifeofmusic.com to find out more information about the film. You can also purchase tickets and, of course, take a look at our behind-the-scenes photos.
Wonderful. អរគុណច្រើនបងប្អូនដែលកំពុងតែទស្សនានៃកម្មវិធីពិភាក្សារបស់នាងស៊ីលី សូមអញ្ជើញជួយគាំទ្រនៃខ្សែភាពយន្ត In the Life of Music ដែលនឹងមានបញ្ចាំងនៅថ្ងៃសៅរ៍នេះដែលជាថ្ងៃទី5ខែ5វេលាម៉ោង5នៅ LA ព័ត៌មានបន្ថែមឬក៏ចង់ទាក់ទងទិញសម្បត្តិសូមអញ្ជើញvisit នៅ website ដែលមាននៅលើទូកញ្ចក់ទូរទស្សន៍នេះជាស្រាប់សូមអរគុណសូមជម្រាបលា